So in recent Ambedkar cartoon controversy, in one of the TV channels when we went live discussing, you referred the coin, you made a coin, you coined a word called Ambedkar as a prophet. You referred Ambedkar as a prophet, and what do you mean by that? Because do you mean that he should not be discussed and he's like a god, like any other, like Vinayagar, like that? So what do you mean by
that? See, when I am talking about Ambedkar being a prophet, prophet is never a god. See, the concept of prophethood and human, spiritual, social, political and economic liberation came in a massive way into the human world, because a prophet is a human being who works with the most oppressed people of his own time, within his own location, and he gives people all kinds of liberative ideas and thoughts. Say for example, Buddha was the first prophet. So he fought the Brahmanic or Vaidic forces and liberated the Adivasis, the Chandas, the Sudras, and put them into one sangha and gave them a life. Now, Buddha did not believe in God. Later on, he is worshipped as a god by certain Buddhist forces like both Hinayana and Mahayana. But Buddha himself was a human being. He could be discussed, he could be taught, he could be critiqued, he could be examined in any way. But he cannot be humiliated, he cannot be insulted, he cannot be he cannot be attacked in a derogative sense. Then what happened? The forces who became Buddhist, the forces who got liberated with his thought, they will not keep quiet, because it becomes a huge social force. That's how Buddhism is now in several countries. Now the second greatest prophet, who actually disconnected between the concept of God and people's socio-spiritual, political, economic liberation, was Jesus was a human being, lived like any one of us, and he had created a thought process, and he said that I am the son of God, and God is far above me, and there is no comparison between me and God. So Jesus became a subject of debate. Jesus, four gospels were debated, critiqued, taught, all kinds of things were done. But a phase comes where his own followers, the feudal lords, the kings, the inhuman forces, tried to attack him as they kill him. Again, in the image form or in other forms, they will not keep quiet. They will galvanize their forces, they will attack. Now the third is Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad was a very ordinary human being, like Ambedkar, like, you know, anybody else. And he was a businessman. Then he became a social liberator, a spiritual liberator of the Arabic tribal communities who were hugely idol worshippers, ignorant, killing each other, women were being burnt alive, women were being buried alive, and so on and so forth. So he first became a social liberator, then became a spiritual liberator, then constructed a Bible, a Quran. Then, you know, he established his own kingdoms also. So a prophet is a spiritual thinker, a social thinker, a political thinker, an economic thinker. He can be discussed and debated, but he cannot be humiliated, or he cannot be attacked, or he cannot be insulted. He cannot be treated as untouchable. He cannot be treated as a barbaric human being. So then I'm also saying that Marx is also a prophet. Why Marx is a prophet? Because he stood by the working class, constructed a philosophical liberation scope for them, and he constructed social theory, political theory, economic theory, and he has his own spiritual theory. He did not believe in God, but he was the liberator in multidimensional forms of the most oppressed of his country, Germany, then Britain. He didn't come to India, he lived in his own place. Similarly, I am saying Ambedkar is a prophet. Now, Ambedkar is a prophet for three great reasons. One, when Ambedkar was born among untouchables in India, no prophet earlier focused around abolition of untouchability. Neither Buddha so seriously, nor Jesus, because he was not here. There was a similar situation in Israel called the Samaritan situation. Nor Muhammad, because Muhammad basically worked around the Arabic tribes. Nor Marx. Marx also did not know that there was this untouchability, there was this barbaric situation. Ambedkar was born in that. And he worked out social, political, economic and spiritual methods, ways to liberate them. Now, one of the basic characteristics of prophets is that prophets work with the lowest of the low, most oppressed, poorest of the poor, and the wretched of the earth of his own times within his own region. And that's what Ambedkar did. There were no much more worse exploited people in this country than the untouchables when Ambedkar took up the cause. Now, having taken up the cause, he worked in the movements, he worked to write about them, he worked to liberate them in various forms of agitational activities, he took them to the temples. When many of them did not work, he worked to give them reservations, education, which was completely banned to them, political rights, economic rights. But finally, he realized that more than anything, it was the spiritual rights of these people that would permanently liberate them. Now, if he did not have a prophetic streak exactly like Jesus and Muhammad, he would not have focused around spiritual agenda so seriously. He would not have critiqued Hinduism so seriously. He would not have confronted the Hindu mythology so seriously. He demolished Rama, he demolished Krishna, he demolished Dashavataras, he demolished Vedas, he demolished, of course, Manusmriti, and so on and so forth. Then he became an Avayana Buddhist. He connected the soulless people, the untouchables, to the most liberative ancient prophetic figure of Buddha. He did not connect them to warmongering Rama of ancient mythology, or Krishna, who was seen as a Hindu upper caste god, nor he connected to any one of them. He connected to Buddha, who was a human being, who was critic. Buddha was critic. These people who are attacking me should read my book, God as Political Philosopher, Buddha Challenge to Brahmanism. Why did I call Buddha a god in that book? Why did I give that title? Buddha in the beginning was an ordinary human being, a prince. Then he became a spiritual agent. Then he became a Sangha organizer. Then he said that I am like anybody else, I am subject for any criticism. Then he established a religion itself and he became a god. So he is god for China, he is god for Sri Lanka, he is god for Japan, is God for Korea, is God for many countries. So therefore I said, God has political power. But Buddha is not God. Buddha is a human being. He didn't believe in the notion of God. Whereas the people believe that he is a God now. Whereas he says people don't think that Jesus is God. Even the Christians think that he is a prophet. He is son of God. He has been sent by God to liberate the Samaritans, the Gentiles, the tribals of Israel situation. Similarly, Muhammad cannot be compared with God. No Muslim accepts him. Muhammad can be critiqued. Muhammad's life can be assessed. Muhammad's life can be examined. But he cannot be treated as untouchable like these intellectuals in the 11th class book treated in that cartoon as an untouchable, as a Dalit, being possible to be whipped. Both Dalits get whipped in the villages. Now a Dalit icon who has acquired the prophetic stature is being whipped in a textbook. Now once this happens, the Dalits and the OBCs who are convinced with his liberation agenda will take cudgels against that. That should happen. All these people must be made to be accountable for their indignified language, either through cartoons or through day-to-day engagement or through any other media, whether they are secular, whether they are democratic. They have not talked about removal of untouchability. They have not written a book, single book. They have not written a single article. They were not with the reservation movement. Now they say that no, we have the right to treat Ambedkar as untouchable. Ambedkar as an indignified person. Ambedkar was the cause for delay of the constitution. In other words, they are saying Ambedkar was incapable of writing constitution like Arun Shauri, and that was the view of Shankar too. What these people did not understand was Shankar, when he threw the carcass in 1949, he seriously believed that Ambedkar was incapable of writing. He was meritless. And Nehru, who was also a lawyer, was more meritorious, would have written a better, quicker, and a quickly adaptable constitution. Therefore, he is whipping, and this whole business of Ambedkar is also whipping the snail. It is like saying that Dalits are whipping cattle and the landlords and the Brahmanic forces are whipping Dalits. Is it not good? It is absolute nonsense. It is not intellectualism. This is intellectual Dalit. That's what I said in post-Hindu. The upper caste intellectual in the name of secularism, socialism, democracy have been doing intellectual Goondagiri for a long time. And that is what they are trying to do now, which we will not accept. We know how to examine Buddha, we know how to examine Phule, we know how to examine Periyar, we know how to examine Ambedkar, and how to construct them. Now, they are not constructed, our icons, in any form teachable in their texts earlier. No leftist did that. No secular person did that. No secular person wrote a book against Hinduism. It is I who wrote a book against Hinduism. Yes, I stand for scrutiny in public. If my book, if the Dalit parliamentarian say that this should be banned, I will accept and withdraw that book. But if the upper caste say no, we will fight it. We will fight it in the street. So Dalits are much oppressed by all sections, including my own caste. Therefore, I treat Dalit representatives as the best judges of even OBC consciousness, even the communist consciousness, even the secular consciousness, even the upper caste women's consciousness. Because the Dalit MPs were the representatives of Dalit masses in reserved constituents. And that is the best yardstick. So Ambedkar is a prophet like Buddha, Jesus, Muhammad, Mark. He is not a prophet. I am not comparing Ambedkar to Brahma, Vishnu, Saraswati, Rama, Krishna. I think these intellectuals lost their brain. They don't read what a prophet is. Prophet is a human being. Prophet is not God. Prophet is not mythical. Now, see, Isaiah was prophet in Israel. Jeremiah was prophet in Israel. And Abraham was a prophet in Israel. They were proper human beings. They were not gods. Therefore, I would again and again say, Ambedkar has assumed a prophetic stage starting from 1990 Mandal movement. And by the time his cartoon was taken into the 11th class textbook by Yogendra Yadav and Suhas Farsikar in 2006, he had already become a prophet. Now you cannot treat a prophet as an untouchable. You cannot treat prophet as a person who could be whipped by a Brahmin. Now they are trying to show that Nehru is whipping the snail. See, these people don't understand what rural students think about. A rural student who does not know about cartoon technology itself, who has been seeing Dalits being whipped every day in the village, if they see the cartoon in this book, if it is his own textbook, her own textbook, they see the Dalit icon, the Dalit prophet being whipped by a Brahmin, whether he was prime minister, secular, democratic, all that does not matter. Therefore, Ambedkar is a prophet of the Dalits and the Bahujans like me. Now, how many OBCs accept him as a prophet is a different thing. How many Dalits accept him as a prophet is a different thing. But I accept him as my prophet. He was the one who connected me to Buddha. He was the one who connected me to, the anti-Hindu heritage, culture, civilization. He was the one who connected me and my people who listen my voice to our own food culture. Today when I talk, beef as our food culture, this is the ancient Indian. This is the Buddhist Indian. This is multi-cushion Indian. And that is what Ambedkar has paved us the way. Ambedkar has shown us. We don't go by what these people require us. They have not given us any voice at any time. They always kept us aside. Now these intellectuals must tell me how many Dalits OBCs are there in JNU? How many Dalit OBCs are there in Delhi University? How many Dalit OBCs are there in CLCS? Wherever they are heading, they are basically anti-OBC and anti-Dalit. They may parade in any name. That parade does not liberate my people. They have not taught to my people. It is we need to teach to our people. And if they want to attack us, if they want to humiliate us, if they want to discriminate us in the public forum, okay, you do it. You have done it for 3,000 years. You are a Brahmin, you are a Chatterjee, you are a Banerjee, you are a Nigam, you are Menon, you are what not, you are everything. And I am Ilaiah like Isaiah, who was a prophet in who was a killer of the land. See, these people don't understand. We come from the rock bottom of the society. We come from the killing soil. We come from the shepherd community. We come from the pot makers community. We are not from Brahmins, Banyas, and the Sudra, Apakas who have ruled this country to define what Ambedkar is.